thought the button was there. All right. Thank you. Welcome back. I would like to introduce Howard Katz, a member of the American Humanist Association Board of Directors, who will be introducing our speaker. Right up to the microphone.
Good afternoon, and I hope everybody's enjoying the conference. It's great weather out there, and it's a very interesting crowd here, too. Our speaker is Karen Garst. She has a PhD in curriculum and instruction from the University of Wisconsin-Madison. I was just there about a month ago. And a master's degree in French literature from the same university, and a BA in French from Concordia College in Moorhead, Minnesota. She served as a field representative for the Oregon Federation of Teachers, an executive director of the Oregon Community College Association, an executive director of the Oregon State Bar. She's married, lives in Silverton, Oregon, and her second book, Women versus Religion, The Case Against Faith and the Freedom, and for Freedom, was recently published. Dr. Garst.
Thank you very much. So this is the workshop you're expecting, right? You want to do this one? Okay, good. So I wanted to tell you a little bit about how I was raised in terms of religion. I was born in Bismarck, North Dakota. What do you think? What religion? Lutheran. The Lutherans, you know, the Norwegians and the Germans. It was Lutheran, yeah. And I actually went to Concordia College, which is a Lutheran school. My Religion 101 class talked about the four oral strains of the Old Testament. I was astounded. Never heard that in Sunday school. And then I was married in a church. We baptized our son, went to a very liberal church, and when it caved, we left. And we never looked, you know, this issue of community, we just slept in on Sundays. We didn't look for anything. And then, in 2014, the U.S. Supreme Court issued its decision in Burwell v. Hobby Lobby. Hobby Lobby is a craft store. But did you know, because of Citizens United, it's also a person. And so, if it's a person, then it can have religious views. And so the court in a 5-4 decision said, oh, you have religious views. You don't want to provide birth control, certain forms to your female employees under Obamacare. Okay. 2 days later, I was having lunch with a friend of mine who's an author, and she said, you have to write a book. And I said, well, the only thing I can get, the P word, which I won't use, is religion. So I reached out to friends, telling their personal stories of leaving religion. I got on the internet. And my first book, Women Beyond Belief, Discovering Life Without Religion, is 22 stories, personal stories of women leaving religion. And then, of course, you know, you can't just write a book. No, you have to have a blog. I think I knew what a blog was. I'm not really sure. But I hired a marketing guy, and the first title he proposed for me was Godless Grandmother. And I said, could we do something that doesn't quite emphasize my age, please? And so we chose Faithless Feminist. I had no idea how the word feminism had changed. I've been a member of the National Organization of Women since the early 80s, NARAL, all of those. But I kind of missed the third wave and all that other stuff. So the other thing I did is I probably read 150 books on religion. I've now published my second book as Women v. Religion, The Case Against Faith and for Freedom, and I'll be signing them out there, which I recruited mostly women who are already atheist authors. We are not a big bunch. You know, there's probably 20, 30 of us. You look at a list of 100 best-selling books in atheism, you're lucky if there's 5 or 6 written by women. So, big issue. Anyway, and so I'm here. We're going to talk about the transition, and this is one of the things I read a lot about, from a female deity to a male deity. Did you know that happened? We're going to tell you why. So, you remember that mythology course you took in high school and you had to remember all the names of everything? Those were pantheons. They were the Greek god Zeus, all of those kind of things. And the Romans said, that looks good, let's just change the names, and adopted them. And then we tried to learn them all in high school. So people are pretty aware that there was a pantheon of gods at one point in time. People are pretty aware that Judaism was one of the first lasting monotheistic religions. It isn't the first, and we'll talk about that. And that Christianity has a huge influence on Western culture. So no disagreement there. But what we're going to talk about is what has the impact been on women from the change from a female deity to a male deity? And how does that impact women in the United States today? We're going to talk about the memes, you know, that Richard Dawkins word, connected with a female deity and how they're different for a male deity. You ready? Okay, we're going to talk about the role of culture. It's fascinating to me that I'm writing and talking about culture when my PhD dissertation was a cultural study of the French school system. I've picked it up to try to read again, but I'm not getting very far on it. So the role of culture influences everything about us. You know, you have a society, you have an economic system, you have institutions, and you have culture. And we'll talk about the different types of culture. And a lot of times it influences us without us even thinking about it. Religion, component of culture, thousands of years. So it's been around a very, very long time. So how does culture reproduce itself? If we're part of a culture, how did that happen? Well, one of the things is spoken language, which probably occurred about 100,000 years ago in Africa. And can you imagine what it was like to, instead of having to show your children how to do everything, you could tell them, and then you could tell them about your mother and your grandmother and your grandfather. I mean, it expanded the potential for our community just amazingly. Music. We were talking earlier about rituals and music. When my sister and I get together, we, in a car usually, so nobody can hear us, we sing all the hymns we had in our Lutheran church. Music's been around probably 55,000 years ago, again, arose in Africa. And then rituals. The last panel was talking about rituals. These are so important to the transmission of culture, and I think they made a really good point about that today. Neanderthal is coming up. You know, it used to be you thought of Neanderthal as this brute, ape, et cetera, et cetera. Well, we're learning much more about Neanderthal, and there is a grave that they found of Neanderthal that was done on purpose. The skeleton is laid out. There's one with two children. There's one that has something next to it, a bone of an animal, and they put red ochre on it because red ochre is blood. It's the sign of life. Now, we don't know whether they thought about an afterlife. We don't know why they did that, but they did it, and they continue to do it, and we continue to bury our dead today. Art, 30,000 years ago, anyone seen the caves in the Paleolithic in southern France? Very cool. 30,000 years ago, this is symbolic. This is the first thing we've done that's symbolic, really. Now, most of those paintings were done in the back of the cave. What we're going to talk about is some of the figurines that are in the front of the cave. So art, critical. Writing, 3000 BCE probably in Mesopotamia. And again, what a giant leap forward to be able to write things down. And writing was first developed for trade, for keeping track of surpluses and different things like that, but look what it's expanded to. And now you don't even need a pen anymore, see? And that probably, well, we said about 3000 BCE on that one. Okay, so let's talk about the mother goddess. If you go back to the Paleolithic, you will see an image, you'll see a lot of figurines, and they call them Venus figurines, and Venus is the goddess of love. It didn't really fit, but everyone calls them Venus figurines, and they're found at the front of the cave where the hearth is, where the women raise the children. This one is on front of the cave, and it's called the Venus of Locelle. All right, let's take a look at her. Pendulant breasts, a lot of these figurines have the same thing. She is holding a horn. It's got 13 stripes in it, and she's holding her belly. So again, we're going to interpret here. Those 13 stripes could be the 13 months in the lunar cycle. Do you remember that women have their period 13 times a year too? Isn't that interesting? Can you imagine what it was like for Paleolithic men to go out in the hunt and bleed and die? But that woman bled every single month and didn't die. And then when she was pregnant, she stopped bleeding. And until the 18th century, they thought that the blood created the child. So 13. Isn't it interesting that 13 now is an unlucky number? So, and we have a lot of images of the mother goddess. This is was on a throne. She's got lions, which later were associated with the goddess. This is in Çatalhöyük in Turkey. Marijigen Budist was one of the first female archaeologists who started exploring these places and looked at them very differently than the men that were there before her. This was found in a grain bin. Like, give us a good harvest. I'm going to put my symbol of the goddess in the grain. Goddess and snake. This is from Crete, 4500 BCE. The snake has been associated with the goddess for a very long time. Why? Because what does a snake do? Rejuvenates itself each year. It sheds its skin. It's like the cycles of nature. So that really matches up with women. Cycles of nature, a tree gives fruit, a woman has a child, they die, another one is born, etc. So I meant to say goddess here, and I thought I switched that, so I'm not sure. This is really a picture of a goddess giving a piece of fruit to a male visitor. Do you notice any other symbols here? A tree and a snake. And we'll talk a little bit about later about what happened when we changed to a male deity. So keep that image in mind. This is a great one. The kind of goddess worship formally lasted in Crete probably the longest. And this is a goddess with snakes and seven layers of her skirt, which could mean, you know, the sun, the moon, and the five known planets. It could be the days of the week. We really don't know. But would you mess with her? I don't think so. Yeah, this woman is tough. She's good. And there's frescoes that they found of a woman on a throne. So probably lasted the longest here. Branch goddess is found throughout the Middle East, associated with a tree. This could have been Asherah. Asherah was one of the goddesses. Remember Baal from the Old Testament and El? Asherah was one of the female goddesses. So you see again, association with a tree, female goddess. And then these clay pillars, I had the opportunity to be in the British Museum, and I saw them, they're this big. They're teeny little things. But they found this throughout Israel. And what they are is kind of like a votive, you know. It's in the private home, you put it there, maybe you light a candle. But again, these are all female, reverence for the female. So what did we just learn from that? Images are very important. Whether it's a figurine or a painting or whatever, images are important. And images are more associated with the right brain than the left brain. Mother-child birth, again, the cycles of nature associated with the goddess. We all often say mother goddess or the earth goddess. Healing with nature. Women, it is believed, were the ones who first saw those seeds grow. Like, well, that's cool, maybe we could plant them. And agriculture started. And they knew which herbs healed, which herbs took away pain, etc. And it's interesting to see the conflict when men come into the healing profession and what they do. So we have cycles of nature in women. Just like the tree bears fruit, the woman has her period, the plants die and come back again. Very important mean for women. And the goddess is seen as part of creation. She's not separate from creation. We'll see the real distinction between that and the male deity. She's a part of it. And then it's all downhill from there. So, advent of the male deity, how did that happen? Agriculture. People started to be sedentary. And when they started out with hoeing, it was often the women who were doing the planting. But once you got to plow agriculture, it really kind of transformed itself to more males involved in that. But people became more sedentary. They formed cities. They formed communities. Invasions. Marijigen Budist, again, has a word for the groups that came down. She favors coming down from the north, and she calls them Kurgans. There's also theories that the people who made a big influence about 5000 BCE came from the desert. We'll probably never really know for sure. One of the things they had was horses. You remember the picture of the centaur with the body on top of the horse? Well, if you had never seen a horse before and you saw somebody approaching you sitting on a horse, that's exactly what you think. And with them, they brought the idea of a male god. Now, first, it starts up kind of in the mountaintop, and then later on, it's a sky god, which is what it ends up to be in Judaism, is way up there. And that god is associated with thunderbolts, war, different things like that. So for a while, they're together. The tribes come in and they say, "Now you got a goddess? That's good, that's fine. We'll just meld it all together." And they coexisted, and you will find, in Egypt, evidence of 3000 BCE, we see this. But the male deity starts to assume a greater and greater role. Militaries. Now we're in communities where we're fighting each other. Cities are fortified. And what better reason to kill somebody else because they don't believe in your God? Religion brought people together. It's from the root word, Latin word, to bind and to bring together. Well, when you bring this together and create that community and somebody creates one over here, guess what? Unfortunately, you're going to have conflict. So, monotheism. How many of you are aware that there's many passages in the Bible that talk about more than one God? Yeah, here's one. God presides in the great assembly. He renders judgment among the gods. What? Oh, I thought there were one. And one of the names for God that I learned in my freshman religion 101 class is Elohim. What does that sound like? Does that sound a lot like El? So Karen Armstrong says it took about 600 years to totally cement a male deity with the Israelites, which is, I think, quite fascinating. 1200 is probably a guess, but by 600, and we'll talk a little bit about the exile in Babylonia, in Babylon, they were pretty monotheistic. This is on a pot, and the writing above the character says Yahweh and his Asherah. Oh, did God have a wife? Maybe. And in the 7th century, they're still railing against the pagan gods. If you read the Bible, you'll talk about whether it's the statue of Baal or something else. So it's taking them time. In 642, Manasseh, who was king of Judah, put Asherah cult objects back in the temple. So this is a kind of depends on the ruler. It's hard to change people's practices. There's a passage in Jeremiah where they say, we're going back to worship the Queen of Heaven because when we did, we had food and now we don't. And so they're telling the priests in the temple, this is no good, this isn't working. And even as late as 609 BCE, when Josiah was king, they're destroying the cult sites in one of the cities in Judah. So, about 586, when they're carted off to Babylon, and this is the priests, the scribes, etc., when Nebuchadnezzar came and conquered Israel, he thought if he took the leaders away, it'd be fine. Well, he took the leaders away, and they still fought against him, so he came and destroyed the temple in another battle, which was the first temple in Jerusalem. So in the exile in Babylon, what were they exposed to? They were exposed to a myth called Enuma Elish, which dates from about 1700 BCE. On the left, you have Tiamat, who's a female kind of sea monster-y kind of thing, and Marduk on the right, and he's a male god. She's female, he's male. And there's other male gods. So Marduk goes to his brothers and said, hey, you make me top dog, I'll get rid of Tiamat. And they're going, sure, why not? You want to be top? Yeah, less work for us, it works. And what does he do? He slices her up to create the heavens and the earth. Does that sound familiar? She's a sea dragon, kind of like Leviathan. And what does God do in creation? Separates the sky from the earth. So there is no doubt that they were influenced by this. I've done some comparisons on my blog between like the story of Noah, I mean the story of an ark in Gilgamesh, again Mesopotamian, and the one in the Bible, and you can just go every sentence, exactly the same things happened, the bird, et cetera, et cetera. So they were deeply influenced by this culture. So if you're going to go against a female deity, you're going to have to demonize her because you're trying to get rid of her. So remember the scene, the seal with the goddess giving fruit to the male visitor? What do we have? We have fruit. We have a tree. We have a snake. So you take all the symbols that are associated with the female deity and make them bad and charge her with original sin. We'll get rid of worshiping women. You bet. Adultery. Adultery becomes important because once you've got agriculture, the man wants to give that property to his son. So the woman has to be a virgin, so you know it's going to be your child, and she can't commit adultery, otherwise you won't know it's your son. Now, you can have multiple wives and concubines and everything, but she can't because of passage. The near sacrifice of Isaac to me is a huge turning point. What do we have? We have the father. We have a son. Where is Sarah? She's nowhere to be seen, is she? And we have the God who's male deciding whether this is going to be a sacrifice or not. God decides not to sacrifice Isaac, but when it's a woman, Jephthah's daughter in the Bible, they kill her, no problems. This to me is a huge turning point where you really get into the male deity and monotheism because the women are gone. What important thing did the female goddess do? Childbirth. And what happens about this period in the Bible? They're barren. I mean, he's got these women who are barren. Again, what better way to put down? No, it's God. That's not the woman who has a child. It's God who caused it. This male God caused it. So what are the means of monotheism? One deity, male. Divine is separate from creation. We've got a real dichotomy here. It's not this cycle. It's not part of it. God says by word something happens, and that's how creation occurs. Written languages replace images. There's a very interesting book by Lawrence Schlain called The Alphabet and the Goddess, and he explores, the whole book is about how does our thinking change from right to left brain when we start writing instead of images. And you remember the second commandment, what does it say? No images of God. Well, Pope Gregory in the 6th century AD had to say we have to have images because people were illiterate, they didn't get the stories. They had to make pictures again. So again, something that's so important for the female deity, you get rid of it. Linear time replaces cyclic, everything's going forward. And about this same time, we have that dichotomy of good and evil from the Persians and the Greeks and the before and the after and the afterlife, etc. So it's a really different concept and more of a focus on a spiritual existence. So what is the impact of that switch been on the United States in terms of women? Well, we're not a leader. You probably knew that. The United Nations Convention of the Elimination of Discrimination Against Women, this is called CEDAW, and it is kind of an equal rights amendment. It is trying to reduce violence, it's trying to increase female participation in education, in politics, being an equal in marriage, etc. Guess who hasn't signed it? Us, maybe two other countries. Everyone else has signed it. Women heads of state missed out on the last election. Paid leave for newborns? Nope. Wage equality? I would argue we have not achieved wage equality. Does anyone want to agree with me on that one for women? Yeah, thank you. Very good, very good. And look at the country that's first. Iceland. I was in Iceland a couple of years ago, and the explanation was, well, the people from the church didn't come till about 1000 AD, and we had all of our myths, but we knew for trade we had to kind of go along with it. but they didn't really go along with it. So it was much easier for them to leave religion behind, and it's one of the least religious countries, as well as Finland, Norway, Sweden, etc., and they have the most gender equality, however you want to define it. So what's important about this? What's important is we need to understand how something happened, and then we need to do something about it. And I think the case of women in other countries obviously is much more severe in the United States, but we have to act locally. So I appreciate that you're members of this organization, or I think you might be joining by the end. And stay involved. And there's a lot of organizations. I was very pleased to hear from the president of National Organization of Women. I don't think I'll ever, in my lifetime, stop being a member. I don't think it's going to go away. I was really pleased what she said about the ERA, though. So that's kind of the conclusion. I will be signing books. Mona asks for some questions. And I have cards with all this information in case you're interested in my blog or something. Don't bother to write it down because I have it. Thank you. Do we have Mr. Mike Guy? Are we going to use a mic here for questions? Yeah, that's fine. And I'm here all weekend, so if you have any questions, please stop me. We got started a little late, so we got to end on time.
Okay. All right. There's a mic. All right.
There's a mic already out there in the middle.
Oh, okay. Actually, is that mic live? Okay, go to the mic there. If you have a question, the first two people to get to that mic.
Thank you. Of course, if it were on, it would help. Test? Okay. Absolutely fascinating presentation, and thank you very much for coming. One legend that I'm aware of, I would be interested to know your take from this perspective. How does Lilith fit into?
Well, I haven't done a lot of research on Lilith, but I can't really answer that. But it's a female character that was in the Bible, but is very subtle to find in the Bible, I think. So I will have.
She was written out of the Bible.
Yeah. Well, and you know, those four oral strains, the last one was the priestly strain that they did in Babylon, and they were really bad editors because they left two stories of creation, they left two stories of the Exodus, and that's probably where they wrote her out. But it's that final, we're monotheists.
Well, for me, it seemed to be because Lilith wanted equality and demanded it off the bat, and you know, because she was created equal with Adam. And the patriarchy couldn't stand the idea of equality with women, so that's why Eve was created from Adam's, you know, from a piece of Adam.
In one of the versions, yeah.
Yeah.
Fascinating. Yeah, thank you.
In the anthropology courses that I've taken, there was a chapter usually on child-rearing practices as a way to transmit culture from one generation to the next. And arguably, that's a woman's role generally in the cultures that I'm familiar with. So what would your comment be on that aspect of continuing these memes that you talked about?
Well, I say I'm doing a debate against a woman who's a men's rights activist at MythCon in Milwaukee, Wisconsin this fall. And so I've been doing a lot of research on gender equality. And I don't think we can blame anyone in the past. You were not responsible for patriarchy. You weren't responsible for letting matriarchy die. I mean, it is what it is. And when you look at the pressure women were under of having child after child after child, and then we get this big agricultural production. If you go to hunter-gatherer tribes, they're much more egalitarian. They don't have this. So I think there was a lot of pressure. And you know, if you've got the powerful king saying this, and they've got the military, it's pretty hard. But there are, we were just talking earlier about Hypatia of Alexandria. I mean, brilliant women who were atheists. But the trend was patriarchy. And I'll be signing books out there.
All right, so thank you very much. Let's give her a round of applause.